Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Sinners who want to keep sinning are fond of quoting Jesus. Actually, it's, I know it's a funny thing to think about. Oddly enough, it's true. They like to quote the Lord. They like to cherry pick our Lord's words. Things like, judge not, lest you be judged. Not looking at the full context of that passage. And they like to cite what our Lord confirmed today in our Luke 10 pericope. Love your neighbor as yourself. For some reason, they always want to skip over the preceding statement. Love God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. Never mind that part, because that must be inconvenient to have a God that you are accountable to. But love your neighbor as yourself. Governor Gavin Newsom used Mark's recording of today's teaching on an abortion billboard, telling people that it was loving to help women come to California to murder their babies. And he quoted it there, love thy neighbor. Yeah. And you guys have heard me talk about the play that the Ferndale Rep put on earlier this summer, The Prom. It has an entire musical number dedicated to gaslighting Christians into thinking that we're hypocrites. After all, if we can't keep God's commandments, if we break God's law, then who are we to tell others that they shouldn't break God's law? How about we all just forget about that business and don't look at all the other commandments, just focus on that one great commandment, love thy neighbor as thyself. Friends, if you don't know, this is what you call theological fecal matter. That's what I call it anyway. I wouldn't put my soul's toothbrush anywhere near where the devil is dropping this deuce. Particles of that filth will get airborne, and before you know it, you'll be brushing your teeth with invisible specks of Satan's filth that should be flushed back to the sewer that Scripture calls the lake of fire. So, don't do that. Don't buy into it. Don't even go near it. But it is true that the Lord does confirm that to inherit eternal life, as the lawyer says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. Do this, he says, and you will live eternally. You will live forever, which we can't help but minimize because we can't grasp what forever even means. But we say, great, I get to live forever. And then we stop and we reflect on it for a second. We think, well, wait a minute. Who can do that? Who can love God with all his heart, soul, strength, and mind, and his neighbor as himself? Who does this? I can't do this. I haven't done this. Can you? No. Then who? Jesus alone. Jesus alone can and has fulfilled what the lawyer rightly read from the Old Testament. And this is why we call Jesus our Savior, because he saves us. He did and does what we haven't and don't and can't do to save us from what we deserve. What we deserve is eternity in the leech field of our own refuse. We deserve this because we do, pun intended, sin after sin after sin after sin. Jesus alone loved and loves God with all his heart, soul, strength, and mind, and Jesus alone loved and loves his neighbor as himself. He is the Good Samaritan, whom he goes on to describe in today's gospel text. And the lawyer is called a lawyer because he knew his Old Testament. The law that he practiced wasn't civil law or ceremonial law. It wasn't marriage law or whatever, this kind of stuff we break it down. No, it was the law he practiced was God's law, civil and ceremonial from the Old Testament. The do's and the don'ts that God established for his people. And Jesus shows that other doers of the law failed to do it when it came to loving neighbor as self. It wasn't just random dudes that he uses as examples in this story. It wasn't random people who went out of their way to avoid the half-dead, naked man on the, lying on the side of the street, robbed of all of his goods. It was a Levite, the priestly class. It was a priest himself. These doers of the law, people who should know better, experts in God's word, like this lawyer. But Jesus, he's the Good Samaritan in the story. Not you, friend. You're not the Good Samaritan. Jesus is. Jesus went to work keeping the law out of love for the wounded man. He sacrificed himself to serve his neighbor. He was okay being put out, so to speak, having his day ruined, interrupted by the need of another. He didn't just sit back and say, this or that needs to be done. Jesus himself went to work, got to work, doing the thing he saw needed doing. He was proactive. He didn't officiate from his high and mighty position in heaven. No, he took on flesh and he dwelt among us, to do the law among us, for us. He got his hands dirty and he got his hands bloody with our sin, with our filth. His toothbrush was in our bathroom. See, there's no Christian compassion in identifying a need and then telling others to go get it done. None of that. There's no partnership. That's what the word compassion means. The code, the partnership in the passion. Passion is suffering, like the passion of the Christ, right? The compassion, the co-passion. He had compassion. He had partnership in our suffering, our passion as those who have fallen from perfection, those who are living in sin. Observing something you want done, but then telling others to do it is not compassionate. What is that, delegating? But that's not passion, that's not partnership in passion. The Lord says the Good Samaritan had compassion on the man in need. He was moved to suffer with his neighbor, to partner in his neighbor's suffering. And so he bound the man and he poured oil and wine on the man. He put him on his own animal. He brought him to an inn. He cared for him, and then he paid for another to continue his work of healing the hurt neighbor because of his absence. He had to leave, bearing the entire expense, up front and afterward. Here's some money, and I'll get you the rest if you need more later. He showed mercy. This is the cross of Christ, Christian. This is what our Lord does for us. Jesus justifies our sins. He forgives them by his work, not by sweeping them under some rug, but by atoning for them, paying for them, bearing the expense and being put out that they would be resolved. And the story that Jesus tells us, it's a robbed man left for dead, cared for by an outsider. That's the story. But in real life, the half-dead, naked guy is you. And the caring outsider, that's Jesus, who pours not oil and wine on our wounds, but water and blood from his wounded side onto us, coming to you by way of an innkeeper. Yes, his pastor, who he puts in place to baptize and to administer Holy Communion in this, his inn, the church, the sanctuary where he brings us to rest and to be healed and to be nurtured, where he bears all the expense to take care of us. He bound you up and he healed you from your sin by dying for you on a Roman cross some 2,000 years ago and administering a delivery system to give you what he earned, what he won on that cross, and to pump it out to you through the means of grace. He put you on his animal, himself being the beast of burden, spreading out his arms so he could bear the weight of all of your sin, carrying you to this place of rest by his Holy Spirit that he sends to us. What's more, in the real life version, not only are you the victim of sin, in need of help, in need of healing, in need of care, which Jesus mercifully gives, but you're also the perpetrator of sin. You're also the Levite and the priest, not just the victim. You're the doers of the law condemned by your own hypocrisy. Jesus shows the gospel by his actions, but his actions, by contrast with our inaction, convict us of our sin. The Levite and the priest stand out as being derelict of their duty because the Good Samaritan does what they should have done. That's the point. And so Jesus shows us his love of God and love of neighbor with all his heart, soul, strength, and mind. And in the process, we see how little we actually love God is far less than with all of our heart, soul, strength, and mind. And how little we actually love our neighbor. We see here in the work of Jesus, the Good Samaritan, a call to repentance. We see a call to depend all the more on Jesus Christ crucified in our place, because his good action highlights our evil work. On the Good Samaritan's cruciform work of mercy, we rely. More often than not, we, even as Christians, serve ourselves from a place of self-justification. It's true. And what's dangerous for us is that we know the biblical ease to rationalize in our heart and make us feel okay when we shirk our responsibilities. Our call to do good works toward neighbor, to show them Jesus. Nothing is gained by denying this fact. In fact, John tells us in his first letter, everything is gained by confessing it. We want to justify our sins. Instead of relying on the compassionate justification of Christ, we want to be the justifiers, not the justified. Like the lawyer, we deserve, or not deserve, but desire to justify ourselves so that we don't get what we deserve. And so what do? We deflect, just like he does. We rationalize away when we should serve our neighbor. Who is our neighbor? Trying to avoid blame and guilt. But other times we do it in a way of projecting. We project onto others what is rightfully ours. We disavow the responsibility and we make it seem like we're keeping the good law. We're doing the Good Samaritan's type of work, but others aren't. When we do this, it's because we're not serving our neighbors and we're projecting what we're guilty of onto others, because we don't want to admit it. Maybe we show up here and there. We make an appearance at this thing or that thing, letting people see our Christianity on display out in the community. We armchair quarterback this thing or that thing, expressing that we, more than others, have a heartfelt concern for our neighbor. We need this. We need that. Come on, guys. Get it together. Be more like me. Sometimes saying as much and sometimes not saying it with so many words. We don't want to actually do the work ourselves. So we're like the priest. We make our part of the work all intellectual and all articulate. We speak about it, but we never cross the street to help. In fact, if we're on the same side of the street as the hurt man, we go to the other side. I wasn't there. I wasn't able to help him. We don't actually want to do the work ourselves. So maybe in our modern context, we'll throw some money at the effort, right? That's an easy get out of jail free card. I really don't want to be bothered by it. So here, can I write a check? Which makes us feel good. Makes us feel like we're serving others. Makes us feel like we're serving God. But if we look at this text, when does the Good Samaritan finally dip into his wallet? He starts this whole process by having compassion. That is, partnering with this man in his suffering. And he's moved to suffer with his neighbor in need, but he doesn't go for his wallet to solve the problem. No, what do we read here? What does he do? He went to him. His compassion, his partnership in suffering moves him to physical engagement, rolls up his sleeves, and he helps him. He's present in the task at hand. And he bound up his wounds and poured oil and wine on them. He's getting his hands dirty. This is what Jesus does, isn't it? Yes. He doesn't just throw treasures from heaven toward our sin problem. He comes down. He engages us physically in the incarnation. Now, we're three steps into the Good Samaritan's actions already, and he hasn't used cash as his way of helping the man. Then he set him on his own animal, and he brought him to an inn, and he took care of him. Three more steps into this process of serving neighbor, and money hasn't even been mentioned yet. He's doing things himself with all of his heart, soul, strength, and mind. He's not passive, which is what money enables us to be, but he's active in the work set before him. So then when does money finally come out? When he has to leave the man. When he has to go. But he wants, his heart still wants to be in compassion. He still wants to partner with this man. And so he still wants to further live a life of sacrificial love to his neighbor, service to his neighbor. And so the next day, full day after this man's compassion begins, he took out 2 denarii and he gave them to the innkeeper, saying, "Take care of him. And whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back." Money is the last thing the Good Samaritan uses to love God and his neighbor. And why is this, friends? Well, there's some practical reasons, because not everybody has it. But everybody is called to serve. Everybody is called to love neighbor and to love God. That's one reason. But also because of the 2 great commandments. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. This is far more encompassing than just money. It's your whole being. The unrepentant sinners who want to quote Jesus as an argument for why they can keep on sinning and to shut us Christians up, to gaslight us into being quiet, they actually do us a great service, as the devil always does. When he brings us the law and he shows us our hypocrisy, they do a great service to us by pointing out this instruction. Because yes, we can repent and be better in our witness, in our work for the Lord. Because learning that we are to love our neighbor as ourselves reminds us that even our good works are like filthy rags to the Lord. Wads of toilet paper on the way to Satan's septic tank. That's your good work, friends. When we realize how much we fail to love our neighbors as ourselves, well, where does that leave us? There's nothing left to do but hit our knees and cry out for the Good Samaritan, Christ Jesus, to have mercy on us, those who have been robbed and left for dead, who are naked, lying on the side of the street. There's nothing left to do but to confess that, like the Levite and like the priest, we are indeed hypocrites. You all take a second chair to my hypocrisy, play second fiddle to just how hypocritical I am, and we should see ourselves as that chief person every time, like Paul says. I am chief among sinners. I am hypocrite of all hypocrites, as we beg for the Lord to help us. And thankfully, what does our text tell us today? In Luke 10, the Lord teaches us just how merciful he is to those who are broken and beaten and left for dead. He shows us mercy. And then he also tells us to go and do likewise, to show his Christian mercy, Christ's mercy to our neighbor. He has had compassion on you, sinner. He has partnered with your sin. He has partnered in your suffering by going to the cross so that you can partner with him in the spreading of the gospel. He has come to you and bound up your wounds, dear Christian. He has poured out his healing sacraments upon you and placed you on his shoulders. He has brought you to this inn where the innkeepers, all of us, take care of each other. In the name of Jesus, he has borne every expense to see to it that you, dear saint, would be healed and finally inherit life eternal. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen.